So before we start, I would want all of us to, you know, slightly, I mean, take a minute, each one of us, and introduce us. And then I will start putting out questions and I'll start putting out the flow of the session. And then please feel free to interrupt, ask questions and give your ideas, because that is what it's all about today. So let me start with Cicero, would you like to give it a go? Like, would you like to introduce yourself and let, because you are also participating with the rest of us, I mean.
Okay, so yeah, my name is Cicero and I run a small digital agency called Crestview Interactive. Also, I run what is called Free Code Camp Goa. So basically, it's a kind of a forum for people who want to learn coding. I myself am not a hardcore coder, but I've always ended up working with tech companies. So that's like, you know, just a passion. And I enjoy teaching. So that's something which I do. So newsletters is one of the things that I generally, you know, not really done it full flow. Because like you said, it's something that you have to really plan out, sort out a whole lot of things. But yeah, that's something that I do. So that's about it.
Lalita, would you like to introduce again? Because we are live now and we are more people. That was an informal introduction which we had.
So we run a trust called Plus Trust, and we work on micro incubation of women's project ideas from rural areas. So obviously it's not a tech product, it's not an app, no, it's not fashionable in that sense.
Yeah.
Most of these women are located in remote villages, and most of the work they do is around either schooling or perhaps sometimes health issues and sometimes skill development for people in that community. So the idea is they work more on services and they do it in their own community. And it's an experience of thinking through the whole cycle of building an enterprise, from idea generation, clarity of purpose, to a point where they are actually implementing something.
Do you happen to use newsletters in any form?
Yeah, we do an annual newsletter. So once a year, it's one effort and we always are late. And for us, it is more like, you know, keeping a record of what we are actually doing. Yes. So we are a 10-year-old organization, and if any time anybody wants anything in our history, they find it in that particular year's newsletter.
Okay.
Because our work was simple. But this year, we are thinking of scaling. And so we started, you know, regular posts in Facebook and LinkedIn and all that. So when it came to doing the newsletter, it looked like, oh, we are already said all this. Why do I put this all in the newsletter? But then if you wanted the human element, you wanted some of those stories. So the challenge was to how do we separate out the purpose of the newsletter and the purpose of our social media presence.
All right. And so who is your typical audience when you, who are you talking with when it comes to newsletter? Because I know that this is more like a report card that you print. Is it a physical newsletter or is it an
Usually, we have not printed it. It's always been electronic.
Okay.
And it is first to people who are interested in our work, you know, our alumni, our supporter network, mostly individuals who give donations. We don't have funding partners. We raise money from individual donations. So it goes to them. And then, you know, people who are in this line of trying to improve education in rural schools, that category of people whom we are in touch with as well-wishers or, you know, advisors and so on.
So your own fraternity.
Yeah, but this year we thought that we should send it out more widely to more individuals, and we also use it whenever we approach somebody for a funding support.
I understand.
We see our newsletter, this is what we do kind of stuff.
Great. Thanks, Lalita. We'll talk more as we move ahead, because remember Amartya Sen saying that we are trying to build a country on the back of unhealthy, uneducated set of people. And we will never become so-called superpower just because we have some shiny tech companies in the country. And so what you're doing, I think that is what we should be doing more. And and less of the everything else which we say.
So yeah, it's very important, I realize. And it really makes a difference for the women and the children in that location.
Yes.
And the
yes.
money needed is very small. People ask for, on an average, 6,000 to 8,000 rupees and for 6 months. And that's it. We exit after 6 months. So that makes, it's a make or break difference for them, you know. So.
Thank you, Lalita. Hi, Nitin. Can you hear me? I see you there. Will you like to speak for a second?
Hi, Abhishek. Am I audible?
Yes, Nitin.
Hi. Welcome. Good morning, everyone. So I'm Nitin and I run this little initiative called Project Bibliotherapy. Been running it since day one of the lockdown. And it's basically an initiative to make people read more.
Great.
So I've been like, I started out on Instagram and then I moved to Stroadstack, a new platform for creators, which just got out of beta last week.
Yeah.
And that's on the content part. And to spread the word, I just launched a newsletter this Thursday. Along with a WhatsApp messaging service of sorts, where you receive a daily nudge to read more. That's been my reason of surviving this lockdown, pretty much.
Okay. I know your presence on Twitter that I've come across that, okay, there's Project Bibliotherapy and you're doing something. So you already have a small audience, like who is following you when you're talking with.
A little audience, yes.
Yeah. That's how it starts.
That's how it starts.
Started
out with zero on 22nd March. So yeah.
Anything specific you wanted to talk, discuss, explore today?
I wanted to understand the whole ecosystem of newsletters because that's brand new for me. Till now, I've been creating content and I've been publishing it and promoting it through social media. But I've just started building a reader list as of a couple of days ago.
Yeah.
That's why I just decided to log in.
So the best playbook for newsletter I've come to realize because I've been doing it for 3 years now. And before that, I was doing it for other brands is the playbook of religions, the playbook of Babas. That's what should be the playbook for religion, recruiting more readers and exact playbook. How do we build that into a written document? Because they exactly know how to increase their followers. And they are not just followers, they are repeat followers. They will devote time, money, everything, effort. And that's what we want for our newsletters.
What you'd like, but the content might be slightly different.
Yes. I mean, you don't have to promise the stars all the time, but yes, it will change.
Exactly. As long as people read more, that's it. My job's done.
Yeah. Thanks, Nitin. We'll talk more. So please ask. I've written down all these things, what Lalita wanted to know, what you want to know. I'll cover that in a while. And then please interrupt me. Please ask as many questions you want. Because it's a very informal session. No one is going to present anything today.
Sure.
So we have Ryan. Is that right? Could I pronounce your name right, Ryan?
Yes. Hi, Abhishek. My name is Mohammed Ryan. So I'm a journalist based in Chennai. And I've been into newsletters for the past 3 to 4 months now. So I've been trying out with a different type of media content, especially focusing on explanatory journalism. So I am active on Substack and I'm also on Scrollstack. So literally I've been trying in different platforms just to see where I can reach more readers. So my point is, hopefully one day to start my own independent media startup that relies only on newsletters. And in fact, I've been participating in so many newsletter sessions. I even participated the one which you organized previously with Rajamalika from News Minute. Yeah, that's about it.
That's fine. That's a great, because we need more people like you who want to start something interesting on new media outlets. Because the reason I think the problem in our media ecosystem is not too many people are wanting to start things. And that's the right way to go, because if you know how to build an audience and it does take a lot of time and effort.
That's true.
It's a good start, but give it time, give it more effort. Yes. It happens. It just takes time and effort. That's it. You're on the right path. We'll discuss more. Ask me questions. Absolutely. I don't know everything, but yes, I have explored newsletters for very long. And I've been doing it for 3 years now. Right. I've built a small audience. Others have built very huge audience, but we also have Indian ecosystem has our own constraints. You may want a lot of audience, but the kind of content you want to put out there, like English in itself puts constraint. Just because you're writing in English, that in itself is a constraint thing. Just because you can go, you know, local or in Hindi or in Tamil, that also does not guarantee you a good audience.
Correct.
So the problem is elsewhere. We'll talk, we'll discuss more.
Yes, absolutely.
Thanks so much for coming and please interrupt and ask all the questions.
Yes, absolutely.
So we have, next we have Vikram. Hi, Vikram. Can we have a minute of yours? Will you introduce yourself to us?
Sure. And apologies for having my video off, but I'm on a poor connection. So, you know, trying to deal with that. I'm head of strategic communications and a junior fellow at IDFC Institute. Uh-huh. We are a think tank and a former journalist as well, about a decade's experience. Uh-huh. We're a think tank based out of Mumbai, or as we like to call ourselves, a think/do tank, because we look at a number of focus areas. There's urbanization, there's the criminal justice system, there's data governance. But the commonality in all of those, the common thread running through all of those, is that we look at it from a state capacity perspective, which is, very often when you look at all the governance problems in India, and civil society organizations go to government. I mean, not everybody, to be fair, but, a fair few, they will go to government with the perspective that, look, you guys don't know what you're doing. Which is not actually true. Bureaucrats are not idiots. They know what needs to be done. The problem is that there are many political economy and capacity constraints which prevent them from executing properly. So they have to look for workarounds. And that's what we focus on, finding out where those capacity gaps are and how state capacity can be built up to actually allow the intent of governance to be translated into proper execution. So that's where we come from. Our audience is fairly diverse. We starting from central and state level governments and bureaucrats to civil society organizations, donors, philanthropists, private sector corporates. So we have to speak to a lot of different people and put across this central message, essentially. Is there anything specific that you'd like to know?
Yes, I would, because I wanted to know. I'm aware of IDFC Institute. We kind of read a lot of stuff which comes out either in Business Standard, LiveMint. I think Vivek Daheja used to be there in some capacity.
Yeah, he was a senior visiting fellow.
So there are various publications which you publish so many papers, and they're very full of the good informative pieces.
So I'm
curious is because IDFC Institute already has access to the best of the media in the country. So what makes you want to explore newsletter?
So, okay, there are two or three different sort of objectives here. Yeah. Number one is that we already do send out newsletters. But the way I look at it is when you send out a newsletter, you're not doing anyone a favor. You're asking a favor, right? You're asking for their time, which means you have to give them value for that time. Now, when an institute like ours, which does a lot of diverse work across areas, when you send out a newsletter, as we do now, updating people on what you are doing, is fine. I mean, it serves a functional purpose, but it's not really delivering value as it should be delivered, right? I mean, everybody you send a newsletter to might not really care to keep up with what your institute is doing. They only want the stuff that pertains to them. So what we'd ideally like to do is build smaller, more focused audiences around certain specific areas like data governance or urban governance, and send them special focused newsletters? They can be informal newsletters, you know, say using a Substack sort of model, which go more in depth about developments in that area, which start conversations, which actually deliver content that, you know, that gets people involved, that gets people talking. So there's, you know, there's the sort of meta newsletter, which is just like, hey, we're IDF's Institute, this is what we're doing. But, you know, I mean, the way I see it, at least, we also need more substantive engagement.
Okay. From what I understand, that your team or your institute already has people who are subject matter experts and they are writers, researchers. So that part is like intact. That's what most people find difficult to do with. Which is to have the right people doing research, writing, and thinking.
Yeah, that we don't have a problem with.
So there are a couple of examples which I know of. I mean, you already know Takshila is doing something interesting in this field. And since they have been at it for very long, when no one was doing newsletter, they were doing that meta newsletter.
Right.
They are also trying to veer towards this this direction. I don't know how successful they are, except their one, Pranay, does that newsletter, which we had him here and we talked with him. So I can understand a bit because I have done a small course at Takshila, so I get what you want to do slightly. I mean, you guys do some great work. So I have written down your questions. I'll come back to it. We'll talk more about it. And we will explore. This is interesting. I mean, since you have been a journalist, so your half of your job is done. All you have to like, the other part is like very repetitive stuff. You don't have to worry for the rest.
Right.
So let me move on to Ekta. Ekta, hi. Welcome to Content Web. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Hi, Abhishek. Hello to everybody. So I'm Ekta and I'm working with Citizen Matters. We are based out of Bangalore. And so we are a civic media news platform. And we have been doing newsletters for quite some time. And I think my colleague was... He attended the session by Raghu Malika and we were a little hesitant to actually join, and we told Zena because what we have been doing so far is really mechanical. So we have a template and we feed stuff into it, which is more like our, you know, like our highlight stories or top stories. And but the idea is also that, you know, we are community funded. So there are like the newsletter actually is a tool which... One is, of course, informing the citizenry of the work we are doing, but the other is also informing them about what we are doing and why they should support us. So there are like two things that we want to really build on. And I think we have like a mailing list of about 11,000 people, which is great. But again, like the clicks we get and, you know, the opening and all of that is, I mean, those rates are, it's pretty decent, but I think given the age we're living in, there's a lot of design aspects that can be addressed because that template is really old fashioned. And I think it doesn't appeal at least the current, the younger generation. So yes, so there's one design aspect to it. And second is also about once you have a newsletter, how do you put it out then? How do you get people to subscribe to it? Because I think like very similar to what you were discussing with Vikram, that content is not really an issue because we are publishing stories. We have a lot of information to share, but what exactly to share and how do you package it is something. So for like many years now, every Saturday at 12 noon, our newsletter goes out and sometimes we modify it, you know, we add like some special announcement or something we have. So. Yeah, looking forward to learning from everybody here.
So what is the platform you guys use to send out the newsletter?
We are using Sendinblue.
Okay. And is it a team which takes care of, like someone drafts it and someone just sets it up and publishes it? How does it happen?
We have, so there are like three stages. One is like the editorial team who recommends what content should go in. And then we have our tech lead who basically feeds it into... like the Sendinblue template, and then it's scheduled a few hours before, and you know, that's how we publish it. And besides that, like we have on our website, like we have a subscribe to our newsletter button.
So other than what your you're taking the already published articles and sending it to your audience, you also repurpose it for the newsletter, or you just take that article and put it in? But when you said modify, what do you guys modify? Is it the design part, or you just modify the content part as well?
The content part. So for example, we usually have 3 chapters in focus cities. So we used to put like 2 articles, top articles, so they're like 6, like 6 image boxes along with like a text box with about 2-3 sentences. So and then now we have also ventured into Mumbai. So we have limited to 4. But at the start, like for example, when we launched in Mumbai, we give an introductory note to our readers, like this is what we are doing. Or we had like a special series on women's safety in Indian cities. So we give like a background note to this is what has been happening in the last 1 week. So that is where we modify in the text part of it, but not really the design per se.
All right. So fair enough. Ask. We'll discuss more. And I have some interesting examples which I can share with you. I'm aware about Citizen Matters. For very briefly, I was in Bangalore. I was working from a co-working and I had someone from Citizen Matters sharing the desk next to me. And that's when I became aware. You guys do some great work. Please come to Delhi as well.
So we are actually, but we haven't like launched a chapter formally, but
yeah. Thank you so much. So we have a question.
Since she said she had about 11,000 people they send it out to.
Yes.
Do you all get feedback from the people who get your newsletter, or do you ask them specifically on a regular basis?
So we don't ask feedback about the newsletter. But for example, for instance, we have a website redesign in place right now. So we put out a survey like to our readers, like, you know, we are designing our website and here's like a quick short survey because we want them to also have a say in what we are doing. So we put out stuff like that, but we haven't really had any concrete feedback on our newsletter other than our team, itself and some well-wishers.
Okay.
So sort of from my limited experience of doing, you run a digital consulting firm, digital marketing firm probably. The best feedback is the outcome which you want from anything you want to do. It's like you're selling detergents, and if it's not selling, no matter how much feedback you take from the users, or is it cleaning your cloth or not, if it's not selling, that's the best feedback. Same is the case with the newsletters. The single largest achievement at times when we publish a newsletter is that we just feel good about publishing it, and then we forget about it, and we don't attach any outcomes to it.
I was looking at it from redesign point of view, because what happens is sometimes when you get it, like, it's nice to take a live perspective of the audience, because they say, okay, this article maybe it was boring, or like we said, I think Vikram mentioned it, that they want to kind of specialize or be very specific. So it's only the person who's actually reading it who's going to tell you that, okay, this is the articles which I would want. And that would probably be one way of getting down to specifics. So it works. It's a similar concept for both, like what Vikram wanted and what Citizen Matters is also doing. So that's how I was just asking from that perspective.
I will very briefly share a model, a framework which people have borrowed from marketing communications, and it's been in practice for ages, for like at least for decades, and it kind of works for the communication firms, it works for marketing brands, it works for also like a lot of NGOs have also used it, nonprofit organizations have used it to communicate. It's very basic. It's called POST, which is called POST. P stands for understanding your people, audience, product, what your product is, what you want to say. O is you have to have a very definite objective. What are the outcomes you want from your newsletter? For what audience and for what particular kind of thing which you want to say? S stands for the strategy. Your strategy should be only about the kind of audience you want to reach out and to achieve that objective. At times we feel that, we are publishing some great content, but if it's not for that specific audience and not trying to meet an objective, it is of no use. It's like if you want to go anywhere, then if you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there. And last is technology, which is at times we kind of get stuck, you know, my newsletter should be designed well. It should have the best logo. It should have this layout. But at the end of the day, a majority of the newsletters are read within the email client, which is just text. And depends like what email client renders in what particular kind of way. A lot of time we want, so there are two ways to use newsletter. One is to let people read whatever is there within the email client on their phones or within on their desktops or laptops. Or you want to like, you want to send them to a website. You want to send them to an article elsewhere. So those are the two approaches. So typically post means that you start with understanding who your audience is. And this is where a lot of feedback research comes. You go out or you meet personally or you call them up. Or you already have a secondary data about a particular audience set. That's what I started. Most of the people, if you go and break down, see what they have tried to do with their products and how they, Paul Graham, someone from Startup World says that know your audience. Marketing says you should have marketing orientation, knowing your current and prospective needs and behavior of your prospective customers. Typical communication also says who is your audience. So that allows, you can have a very specific approach to it. You can ask 10 questions, what demography, what is your usage pattern, what do you guys read, what is your behavior, what are your likes, dislikes. And so Facebook gives you a whole lot of information, or you can just speak, oh, this is the kind of audience I want to speak. Let me just call up 10 people and know what they want to read. Objectives, there are various frameworks, there are objectives and key results. You can just write down, oh, I just want people to read and respond to this particular survey or this particular quiz, or they just want, I'm sending out a question, they should reply to that. That can be a simple objective. Other objective could be to reach out to make more people aware about your work, make more people join your organization or join a particular initiative, or they should start donating more. Or at least the query should be there, you know, okay, how can I do something? So these are the various objectives. Strategy is where the interesting thing happens. So we see that everyone wants to start a Substack. There are people who are using something from Amazon, SendGrid. There is Campaign Monitor. There is Constant Contact. And there are endless tools out there. But as people say that your tool can't be your strategy. Just because you're on Substack or Scrollstack for that matter, people will not be reading you because that's still the age old thing that you have to do the knife fight for every single audience. For the first couple of years you add to your list, it will be a lot of hard work. You may reach the inflection point in the very first year or in the first 6 months, but till then it will be very difficult. You have to do the street fight. You have to go and fight with each and every person, recruit them for your audience list. And the last bit, technology, yes, it is an issue because now you have to figure out, should I have, like most of us have our own domains, how do we map the domain? Because then we can benefit from a bit of SEO from it. We get discovered more often because if you just publish within the MailChimp's ecosystem, you're caught up there, you're not able to reach out to more people. It's not working when you're not using it. And then there is social media, like everyone has this magical vision about social media. If you're just publishing there something, millions of people will be listening to you. So, but there is a way to it, which is social media at best is just like another channel, like television, like radio, like newspaper, magazine, and you work on it, which is you use it the way it has been designed. Now it's not designed to just publish and people, millions of people will read it. So let me again go back to Lalitha, because what the best way would be, like, I'll take up a question from each of us and I will introduce you to some examples and references. Lalitha, I remember you asking that you are now trying to move more towards publishing more number of, not just an annual newsletter, you want to do more newsletters and you want to use social media for that. So what is it that one problem which you would want us to, like, all of us to discuss and see if we can all contribute there?
See, my audience changes because right now we are in the middle of trying to scale up.
Mm-hmm.
And so far we were writing to audience who are English tech savvy. Now I want rural women with some bee in their bonnets to be able to read it.
Mm-hmm.
Or if they can't read it, at least listen to it, see it.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to come up with a completely different way of presenting our work. if we are to increase our pool. Because if we talk to, I mean, if we get 100 women to think about our workshop, maybe it translates into 5 people actually taking up this project, which, you know, is a rate for any kind of entrepreneurial activity. Not everybody who dreams of an enterprise is actually ready to do it. And we see it in the failures rates in startups and so on and so forth. So we have to be, we want to be growing fast in the coming years. Mm-hmm. And we have to really think through our strategy for reaching a completely different layer of the population.
But this is a different problem, Lalita, no? Because this is a more of an operational issue. But what you were trying to discuss before was you want to do more newsletters and you want to use social media because...
Yeah, these newsletters, we want to be quarterly and it should inspire people to look at our work. And, you know, it's not inspiring people to contribute to us. It's inspiring people to actually take up this kind of micro incubation, particularly rural women.
So you have to like... Now, newsletters can only do as much. You know, you can't have newsletters doing everything for you. So what I would suggest, and this, if I were you in your team, I would take the newsletter and try to do more of what it is capable of doing as of now. Okay. Like if you want, if which is you have your alumni, you have your donors, you have general public reading your, and then your own fraternity or educators. And so if this gives you more benefit and this is where you're lacking in terms of reaching out to them more often, that is what I would aim. That would be my first step because to
try to maybe they do a half yearly newsletter instead of an annual. Even that would be a step up.
Yeah, that would be a step up. And since you are also trying to use social media. So just by publishing on social media without knowing who your audience is, because what social media does these days is it only allows you to reach about 5% of the people who follow you. Say, if say 100 odd people follow you, only 5 of them would be able to read. They won't even read. It will just appear in their timeline.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if they read or not. Say something appears, if you're reading your Facebook, you go and log into your Facebook, countless things come in your timeline, which you don't read all.
Yeah.
Exactly. So imagine only 6 people get your content in their timeline and all of them, whether it is LinkedIn, whether it is social, Twitter, they will not even read it. So even if you're publishing very now and then on social media, the guarantee that it will reach at least even like 10% of the people is like minuscule. Unless you are or your organization is like a celebrity, a very famous, people really want to read, you know, know
surely
about them.
Surely we're not there yet. Yeah.
So that is the problem. So the first step should be to be able to do more of what has already given you some results and do it better, which is have a clear map of your audience, like define your alumni, who are your alumni, and you start getting some more interviews from them. Hey, we send you the newsletter. Do you want to read more about something? Can we send it to you more often? Is there more which you want to read? Same as with the donors that, okay, we'll give you a yearly report card anyways, but do you also want something quarterly, something half yearly? And also with the general public, because that's a step number one. And that in itself will give you a great number of ideas. Maybe they'll say, hey, we just don't want yearly, quarterly, then we want to send you something monthly to us or fortnightly. But then maybe fortnightly, you won't send like a huge newsletter, which you do, but maybe a small update. So that is what I would think if I were to do the newsletters for. I mean, I want to do the more of what works and do it better.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So these are the things which I can share more. We can have maybe more sessions around that in the future, wherein an organization like Plus Trust, how can they use newsletter in a different way? In a way that it maximizes their impact on the audience they want to reach out to. And like your alumni will give you a different outcome, donors will give you a different outcome, general public will give you a different outcome, and your fraternity will give you a different outcome. And that has to be like fairly written down. Like this is what we want from our newsletters. Like we send 10 newsletters in a year, or 12 newsletters, or 6 newsletters. And then we have to like map the decision journal. These are the decisions we took. these were the outcomes that happened because of those decisions. Whether they were right or wrong, we can assess it in the future. That is how we should go. I mean, I'll take it down. Anyone else wants to ask Lalita something interesting, or they would want to contribute and offer an advice? No? Shall I move on to yes,
yeah, that's okay. Yeah, but what I was saying is, I think she mentioned that she was looking for people to maybe attend their programs or sessions. So for that, I would generally say is that maybe when you're sending out the newsletter, having worked with an organization that has been in the entrepreneurial space, it's very, very difficult to get people to just come into a program of a newsletter. You always need that personal touch of, like, you know, talking to someone and then getting convinced about it. So maybe you could just, like, when you're sending out the newsletter, you could just put something which says, like, you know, that if you know anybody or if you're interested in joining this program, this is a number to call. That would work because it's kind of worked with the organization that I was working with. And that would kind of get people to, like, you know, maybe call in, and then you would get to convince them that, you know, maybe you can join for the program. So it's just a small thing which you can do, because it's just one line which you're adding to all your newsletters. But that would probably work towards converting people into attending your programs or sessions.
Yes. Hey, Nitin, coming back to you, we'll discuss more about Project Bibliotherapy, because yes, and since you just joined ScrollStack and you also joined Substack and WhatsApp ecosystem, and you wanted to know how does the entire ecosystem work like? So Sarah, would you want to answer? Like, would you like to talk with Nitin and share something which you have?
No, you take it over. I'll just drop in anyhow.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Nitin, can I ask you a couple of more questions?
Sure, go ahead.
Who is your typical audience like? I mean, I've given you the framework, it's post POST. You'll just touch each of these like very briefly and then maybe think of doing something interesting.
Okay, so my typical audience is pretty vast. I haven't done segmentation per se, but for me, I consider myself to be a champion audience, because I'm not targeting anyone, any specific genre per se. I just post whatever I like to read. And I, out of all the things I can say I'm good at, the only thing I can say with surety is that I read a lot. That's all I've been doing most of my life. And I come across articles dating back 20 years from the inception of the internet to stuff which are long reads and just escape people who have like minimum attention spans, myself included, just disappear from Twitter timelines. So what I've been doing is I've been collecting all those links and I've been repackaging them in the form of magazines. So this Substack, which I just started, is called Bibliotherapy Zine. I've already been publishing on ScrollStack since July. But the email model is something which I've just started exploring. As you mentioned, I started off with Instagram. All the social media algorithms have gone haywire. Everyone's out there.
Yes.
Way too much clutter. Even so, I don't read 90% of the things which come up on my timeline, and I consider myself to be a reader. So, yeah. That's my main issue. And what I'm trying to do right now is I'm trying to migrate my social media presence, my Instagram audience, I don't call them followers, towards a model where at least I deliver whatever I have to send, be it in an email format or a WhatsApp message, so that it's there with them whenever they want to check it out, whenever they want to read something which Douglas Adams wrote 20 years ago. They can access it. It's not like lost in a sea of Twitter, whatever tweets.
Yes. I mean, we can like have this entire session that how a publisher who is kind of publishing what you're publishing should be approaching this, and how, so there are, I don't know if you're aware of maybe 5 books, they do something similar, or browser sends you a mail.
Browser sends you a mail.
Yeah.
Scroll is doing it. Yeah. They've got like send books every week on Stories.
Yes. So my, and then the endless people are doing it. Not that exactly. This is, but the great thing about what you are doing is, it's always the context. It's not that, oh, everyone else has been doing it, so why should I do it? Everyone reads book. They have been sending recommendations since ever. There's Goodreads and so on and so forth. My understanding is the context which you have, and every media outlet, every media platform has a place. Like for Instagram, or say you run a small ad on Instagram, say for $500, or on Facebook for $500, the chances of you finding your core audience is increases many times. And that's how it should be used most of the times, which is a paid search model. And then there are serendipitous things happening, like someone discovers you and they like you so much and they start following you. That will keep happening. And that at times just happens out of the blue, and all of a sudden there is a mention in the media and there is a news. There's someone has written about you, profiled you, and then you have to be present on those platforms to harness that and shepherd people towards your how to build your audience. With the single thing is you have to have a place somewhere on the web where you clearly define what you want to do. It can be anything which you want to do. For the kind of audience, you have to have some idea. It can keep changing over of time. It can keep like, okay, you want to reach out to people who are from 24, 35 or 45 or 55. And then you have a rough, you can have like 3 or 4 personas in your mind. These are the 4 kinds of people I want to read. And that will drive your copy on the news, on the website. Hey, this is what I am sending every week, every Friday, every Saturday. It will be this and let me know. That is, I mean, we'll have more to discuss. That's how, so tools don't matter. You can be on Substack, you can be on MailChimp, exactly. You can be anywhere. Yeah. But
it's the content and the distribution channels, basically.
Yeah. And if you can also tap into existing networks, like if you have a friend who sends a newsletter and it goes out to 5,000 odd people or 10,000 odd people, you can say, hey, this is what I'm doing. Would you like to give me an introduction? You have to like beg and borrow, and you have to be shameless about plugging yourself. You have to repeat yourself. That's how you sell. And since I'm from Delhi, if you ever been to a small, like,
I'm also
like
from
market,
Delhi as well.
You're from Delhi. If you've been to Lajpat
Nagar. I also have a sales background. So a little background about me.
Yeah.
I was working in sales. I had a 7-year sales career till 2017, August.
Yeah.
And then I decided to take a sabbatical, which carried forward to more than the original planned year.
Yeah.
And then the pandemic happened. And so what I'm doing right now is basically creating a publication of sorts where I'll be posting original stuff as well.
Okay.
So that is the ultimate game plan. But I mean, I don't want to be writing and just putting it out there
in
the Twitter and the Instagram ecosystem for people to find it in the blue. So yeah.
So sorry to break this to you, but you haven't left your sales life behind. It's still
actually I'm planning to use that to sell my stuff rather than biscuits or ads as was earlier. So
I don't think any sales guy leaves his password behind. It's like once a sales guy, always a sales guy.
The sales guy. And yeah, we have given it a name, but we can call it by some other process. But yes, it is important to
spreading
not just
word.
Put
that to sales.
Exactly. Spreading the word, asking people to join your community. As I told you, you have to follow the religion wala formula that become the Baba, and you can be a good Baba and not a bad Baba. But yes, that's how it is. You have to convert people. It takes time. The other thing is that the easier option is to figure out where people are already wanting to do this, you know. And that is the, like in marketing, it is always said, don't try to convert people. Like if you're a gym brand, don't go to fat people and say, hey, you should lose your weight. Try to find people, those who are already excited about working out.
Exactly.
And that's the first audience which you should reach out to.
So that's what I've been doing on Instagram. Like reaching out to fellow readers, fellow bibliophiles.
Yeah.
But the whole Instagram algo has been messed up. So that's
great.
Let us next.
So Vikram, we'll talk a bit more with you if you're still there. Vikram. You wanted to discuss how you want to like slice the huge amount of content which you guys produce, which you have, and then reach out to the more specific audience.
Right. So that's the broader question, but also within that, how do we make sure that what we are delivering is of value? Because, you know, since the entire idea behind these more targeted newsletters is that you're offering something that is really worth the reader's time. Now, and given how diverse our audience normally is, you know, we might, I mean, as you said, we have a lot of content. We might put content in that we think is fantastic, but you know, you never know if that's something that the audience actually wants to read. So how to sort of bridge that gap, and yes, also slicing and dicing the audience. So those are the two main questions. There are also, you know, smaller sort of operational questions, which I think everybody here, I'm sure, would be facing, which is, so for example, one of the areas we work in is data governance, right? Now, you know, best practices, best privacy practices sort of mandate that all newsletters should be opt-in, not opt-out. But if you do that, then given that people generally, you know, if they see another email saying, hey, we're starting a newsletter, if you want to sign up, click here, you're really, you know, not going to get much traction or much feedback. So it's tempting to take the easier route and, you know, your mailing list, your existing mailing list, just send it out to them and give them an opt-out chance. But that's not really how it should work ideally. So just small operational questions like that.
Yeah. So I'm not a big votary of opt-out because I would never do that even if I have. So since I have mostly worked with brands and they had always like, they had given us their shady mailing list, which they were also okay to use with if we wanted to when I started my publication, and I decided not to. So I had lacks and lacks of people who I could, like CXOs I could have sent my newsletter to, and because my newsletter is about small businesses and independent brands, I did not choose to do that. And it is very difficult because you have a huge mailing list lying next to you and you're not using it.
Right.
But the good part about not doing that is that you actually build your community from ground up. Even if you have like 100 odd people in your newsletter, like on your mailing list, they are invested in what you're doing. The kind of feedback which you get from them is priceless. And they force you to do some interesting content. They ask you questions. So that part you would miss out if you're like using.
That's an interesting way to look at it. Yeah, that's definitely a perspective.
So yeah, even in real life, like if you imagine, I mean, if you think, you have like only those 5 people who kind of always push you to do better. You don't like always meet like 500 people to get the best ideas. I know people want to speed up their community, like they really want to bring, but to tell you the truth, it does not, it will take you at least 3 years to build a good community of any reasonable size. So people say, oh, we have 50,000 people who subscribe to our newsletter. And if they haven't gone through this route, the chances are it's just a number. They may report what sort of like metrics, or these are the open rates, because you tend to open the newsletter at times. The first thing you do in the morning is open an email. But if you're not going through it, you're not spending time on it, it does not matter.
Yeah.
Coming back to what you were saying, that okay, these are the things you want to build. I've always been a news buff. I'm not a journalist. I've never been, but I've always been a news buff. I always try to follow how they. I've tried to read their books, how they write their articles, how they build the entire thing, how Bloomberg tries to come up with articles, or how Washington Post writes their articles, and if they've written a book, how. So the same approach applies here, which is you have to have a manual, a style guide, a content strategy for the audience, and you publish that part of it. When you say that you want to build an audience around data governance, or you want to do something around, say, policies, government policies, and you want to empower them, the first thing would be to imagine any 10 odd people who would want to subscribe that. And then reach out to those people and just ask the very basic questions. I know it comes because since you have been in this field forever, for you it will be easier. But when you go back to your team who is not doing this, who has not been a journalist, it will matter to them. It will help them.
Right.
Hey, we want to start a newsletter. Can you reach out to 10 odd people and ask them what is it that they read and what is it that they want to read?
Right.
It's very cliched. It work because for you, it is very automatic. It's like inbuilt in you. But for others who are not there, it takes time to understand this.
No, fair enough. Fair enough.
So that is one thing which, I mean, and whatever you have discussed demands like more time for us to delve each one. How would you, so when you say donors and you say corporates and you say these are the kind of audience you want to reach out to, there has to be a, you know, trade-off that you cannot just be saying that, hey, like you're already sending out newsletters and there's nothing wrong in asking people, hey, we have another newsletter, would you like to join? Because there you're not forcing them to do something.
Right.
You should do that. Repeating yourself often, if you, I mean, that's something which is said in marketing. If you look at a campaign which happens on a television, you at times wonder why is this guy showing me the ads of MDH Masala every day. But such is the human psyche that you, it's very like, as you watch it, it, the impression it leaves on your mind, it reflects, it manifests like 3 days later.
Right.
Or when you are in the market trying to buy something. So when you send a newsletter, exactly. Top of the mind recall comes in at that moment.
Yeah.
So these things are being, I know I have some journalist friends and they really don't want to do this. What they always look, I mean, they always like crack a joke that you are a marketer, you always talk like this. But we can combine best of both the worlds and try to build a good newsletter.
Right. No, I mean,
No,
sorry. I was just going to say that, you know, one of the ideas that we had discussed internally was, you know, talking to people to figure out what they wanted. And we weren't sure if that was a good way to go about it. So it's good to hear that that's, you know, to get the validation that that's something you're suggesting as well, that that is an effective way to gauge what delivers value to your readers and, you know, what would be worth their time.
Yeah, one of the things which I have used in all my professional career and then borrowed it from investors, they maintain a decision journal. And decision journal is very simple. These are the decisions I took on the basis of these facts. And then you don't really have to have a template and then go into the future and say, did it work out or not? So if it worked out and it did not work out because of the decisions you take, there's something wrong with your decision. And if it did not work out and you know why, you already know why it did not work out because you've taken those decisions, you listed it down. The same I applied to my newsletters. In one of the newsletters, I wanted to seek their views about something which I wanted to launch. And there was no interest whatsoever from anyone. So then I figured out, oh, that no one has replied. But then I changed the question. Then I changed the style, tone, and there were replies for it. So otherwise I would have thought, oh, no one is interested.
Right.
But then I figured out, no, the problem was something else.
Right, right.
So maybe we can talk more about, like, if you want to build a smaller audience, you can start with something which is generic, like a Substack. And if you start to see a ramp up, then you can shift to more domain mapped within your own domain. You can map it and turn that into a better thing. You have to use social media also to get more people. I mean, you can use LinkedIn because you're more focused towards a different audience. You don't have to be on Facebook. You don't have to be on Instagram. Mm. You could be LinkedIn and Twitter. But it's a small... it's like POST stands for like, okay, this is my strategy would be to also to reach out to people.
Right, right. And the advantage here is that for these sort of domain-specific newsletters, we are not looking for huge audiences. We're looking for good audiences.
Yes.
So I think that fits well with what you're describing.
So Pranay had shared on the talk with us that their audience is not more than like, they don't have more than 2,000, 3,000 odd people subscribing to their newsletter.
Hmm.
Yes, Abhishek.
Hi, Soumya. Welcome.
Hi, good to see you guys.
Yeah, Soumya. So we were discussing with Vikram about your newsletter that Vikram don't want to build a huge audience around our newsletters because these are like small around data governance and something like that. Pranay had mentioned that, yes, the newsletter which they send out does not have more than 3,000 more than 3,000 odd subscribers, and it works for them because in the policy sector, we is there and people want to read more about.
But you'll be surprised that, in fact, people who are clued into the newsletter, they are the guys who refer others with similar interests, right? They tell, hey, there's this cool newsletter called Anticipate the Unintended and you should look at it. They like the content and all of that. And like you were rightly saying, Abhishek, I think it's not just about the numbers, right? The curation, and even if 10 people find it meaningful, you should go ahead with it, because our experience, we have about 5 newsletters from Takshashila going out on a weekly basis. Our audience is completely different for each one of those, right? The China interest guys will never end up looking at something on the tech and policy side, and people in tech and policy will not consider the health one. But you should be okay with the numbers. And I think a steady organic growth is useful, because these are the guys who will participate, write to you and say, hey, you didn't send something this weekend, what happened? Or, you know, can you cover on this topic? So a lot of times we have got inputs from the audience who kind of consume the content rather than us thinking this is more relevant. So I think it's important to kind of get those signals right, because our conversations with our own alumni has led us into doing things because they feel, oh, I've researched enough about this. I don't find good content out there which is curated, because most people don't have the time, right? And recently I started something for Takshashila, which is the alumni newsletter. And in a week's time, I got good response from our own community of people saying that, hey, this is one place where I can see the job openings. And I think somebody in between mentioned about donors and organizations and that mind space to occupy, right? There are a lot of people in corporates always telling, like, I don't have one place to go to and find all this useful information. So if somebody is helping you curate, you know, good reads combined with, you know, what different organizations are doing, plus, you know, job opportunities or, you know, just stories of people which could inspire others to take such a call, I think that's useful. But there was, I don't know, Abhishek, if Zainab had actually sent a couple of questions that you guys had more in terms of audience development. I think for us, moving to Substack has been useful. I don't know what's your experience. MailChimp was a little painful, at least for me to operate on. And I feel Substack is a better platform to use it, though there are some glitches that need to be fixed. Overall, I think it's seamless in terms of how the content gets displayed and even getting the CSV file on it, and simple you know, administrative hassles that I used to go through with MailChimp, I see Substack is a lot more easier that way. I don't know if you guys use any other platform.
Okay, I mean, for me, platforms, I mean, others, I think Ekta had mentioned they use SendGrid, I guess. Okay. Vikram, I don't know if you have already started using, you have started building new newsletters, still are with the Meta newsletter.
We are still at the planning stage, and the Meta newsletter is using MailChimp, but for the smaller newsletter, we are thinking of Substack.
Okay. Yes. Yes. So that's pretty much now this, I mean, everyone is using MailChimp as their so-called formal newsletter, and they move on to Substack. I'm agnostic. I don't care whatever is the platform. I can use Constant Contact. There's Campaign Monitor. They're endless. And since HasGeek hosts these sessions, which is like part of Content Web, and they would be like Shawvik and these guys, they understand newsletter from the point of view, from the back end. They say that at times you can build your own newsletter. People are already building those newsletters. I mean, so ease of usage is secondary in terms of, I would rather go for, even if MailChimp is painful and if it is getting you more users, maybe that will help us, because our outcome is to increase the audience and build the audience. But yes, Substack is far easier to use than MailChimp. And I use MailChimp. I don't use Substack, but I understand it's easier to use. MailChimp will allow you to map your domain. MailChimp will allow you to also create landing pages. MailChimp can allow you to also do surveys within the same ecosystem, and so on and so forth. So it's a trade-off. When you do MailChimp, there are a few things that you will find useful. If you do Substack, there are a few things you'll find useful. Anything that you would want to like know more, Soumya, about doing newsletters, and you've done 5 of them, there's something that you want to like, you think that it will help you.
More in terms of specialists, right? I've really come across a lot of people who specialize in these domains reaching out to us because they've stumbled upon the newsletter, and that giving opportunities to broaden the horizon, right? Like being in relevant forums for conversations or inviting for roundtables. So that community grows not just in the increase of newsletter, but being in relevant places where such conversations are happening, right? Like the PLA newsletter is a very technical one on the geopolitics side. But mm-hmm. who's who of the country looks forward to it because, again, one place to go to, right? And look, it's a lot more easier when you have a curated set of links to go through. So that way, I think the reach has maximized in some sense. I wouldn't say it's literally attached to the newsletter numbers, but the places that you get to be and with similar interests and the community of people who are invested and interested in it. So that's been very useful for us.
Is there something which you're grappling with, which you want to solve a problem, which you have a problem these days with regards to newsletters, which you have not been able to solve, other than the love for the MailChimp, which a lot of people have in this group, including Zainab? She's not here, but... That's something which we can all like crib about, but yes, it's there. We can. So there are ways to take care of that problem as well. I'll come back to it later. But is there any other problem which you want to solve?
No, nothing for now, Abhishek. I'm kind
of great. So what we can also do is, Soumya, we can have one of these sessions where we discuss what are your best practices in terms of from your point of view, not. Like Pranay says, oh, this is how I write a newsletter.
Yeah, yeah.
But since you are doing most, you have been taking care of the community and this is part of your profile, how you... Yeah. So you have to like give Lalita, Ekta, because Ekta has been trying to... They have a huge mailing list of 11,000 odd people. They're mm-hmm. trying to change things. They're trying to use social media. They want to change design. So maybe they will get a perspective, hey, we don't maybe need to do all these things because this is probably already working for us. We mm-hmm. should just keep doing this. Mm-hmm. Eka, are you still there?
Yes, I'm here.
Anything specific you wanted to ask since Soumya is here and you guys are obviously in the same city, but in the same kind of domain as well. And you talk with common public and anything which you are struggling with, which you want to like take us up in the future and do specific sessions about it.
Yeah, I mean, one is like this whole nonprofit space and, it's something because we aren't selling anything. We just want more, like the whole idea is that people read more and they're empowered to take action. So that's like the whole idea. So that's like one aspect of it. And the second is those who actually feel empowered and they want to support because some people cannot go on ground and contribute like other citizens do. So probably if they could support us, financially, and whatever it is, 500 rupees to anything, so from that, receiving donors perspective, donations perspective. So these are like two things, but it just clicked to me, like you were saying that we might realize that what we are doing already is working for us. So do we really need to revamp everything and, spend that much time and resources on it? So yes, there are two things, but I think what one takeaway has been like, I don't know, I would want to know more about this. How do we exactly engage with the readers or those that whole mailing list that we have that, what would you want to read? Like, what do you expect out of this newsletter? Because the perspectives not all 11,000 open, right? Very few out of that open. But how do we, because it's a wide audience out there. So how do we really get their perspective and then design something, come up, curate uh-huh. something which appeals to them as well as takes care of our interests. So that is something I'll be like interested to know because uh-huh. just put a survey link is easy, I know, but it's the work after that, how do you analyze it and build things.
Great, Ekta. Because we are not going to discuss the solutions today, but we will definitely get back because I see a common thread with you, Lalita, and also Vikram was discussing a few things. This is how we want to take, which is like, okay, this is a great tool we have. What is the best way to use it? For you, I see a very clear outcome that you want people to participate. With Lalita, she wants more people to join the program. And maybe more people to also donate. With Vikram, they want to engage more people from that particular domain. Nitin is mostly about building the community at this point of time, and maybe subscribe to the newsletter. Ryan wants to do the future media upstart. So his approach would be different. So we have like, I can see like 3 or 4 broad sessions in the future, which we can do and work around and we'll come up with in the future. David, Cicero, do we need to discuss more, or we can like call it a day and then come back and discuss more and invite, like think of future sessions? Cicero, are you there?
He's on mute.
Yeah, sorry. Try to keep it mute because there's a little bit of noise in the background.
Exactly.
Maybe we could just check one last thing with Ryan if he has anything specific that he wants. But overall, I think we can cover it and work out something for the next sessions.
Ryan, are you there?
Yes. What I've noticed is ever since starting my own newsletter, I've been trying out with different content strategies. One thing I'd like to know from Abhishek and other participants is how do you, maintain consistency in producing your newsletter? So do you keep it weekly, or is it, once in a week, or is twice a week, thrice a week? So about that, maintaining consistency in producing a content.
So I believe in doing things with the lowest common denominator, which is like do something which happens smoothly, like slow is smooth and smooth is fast. So if you are able to, so you may get very enthusiastic and say, I want to send newsletter every day, right, and you send it for 5 days and then you stop doing it. This is what I've seen people do, is like they start sending newsletters and then they disappear after 4 months or 3 months or 6 months. My idea is start with whatever regular, like if you want to send fortnightly or monthly, start with that. Be on it, send it on the same day, same time. And then if you want to ramp it up to fortnightly and then weekly and then twice a weekly and then weekly, take it like that. But your readers, if I send my newsletter every Friday at 7:30 a.m. in the morning. Come rain or sunshine or whatever, it has to go at 7:30 a.m. in the morning. And the benefit of that is my readers start to expect that, okay, 7:30 is going to be there. There will be a newsletter. There will be a mail from Abhishek. So they don't. So in that crowd of like thousands of news emails which someone receives in the morning, you will always stand out because they're expecting your mail to be there. Right. So start with something very doable, like, because if you already have a job or if you're already doing something else, start with something like, okay, I will send something fortnightly. And it's always like over delivering and under promising. So you start doing something monthly and then all of a sudden you say, now I'm ready to do fortnightly, your audience will love it. And you say, I want to do it weekly, then they will love it even more. Right. So that's how you should go about. Content strategy is very simple. Start with like 6 things you would, again, it's about being consistent. If you're changing your newsletter every time, your readers will kind of start to get confused. So if you remember, like there are presentations which every slide is like a new thought process, which becomes like very confusing by the time it ends. But there are a few people who just say, okay, on the top left, there will always be an index, the slide number or the topic. So the audience knows I'll read topic on the left and this guy will write something on the right and there will be an image below. So that consistency, I'm just giving you a very basic example. So if you maintain a basic consistency with regards to content strategy, it helps for your audience. You can always announce in advance, okay, I'm going to change something, and then you keep doing it. They'll love that as well. So consistency is the key. And this is, imagine all of a sudden Republic publishing something like NDTV, you will get confused, or maybe you will not even watch it. No matter you like that content,
right?
The audience will be put off. They don't want to see that happening. I'm just kidding. They can do whatever they want. But the idea is you choose a persona, you choose a tone, you choose the content, and you stick to it for a while and then change it slowly. But don't be very over enthusiastic just because you have the best content today. And correct, you can repeat yourself also every now and then. It's perfectly fine. But be consistent. Like every Sunday, if you're sending a newsletter, do it for 3 months. Analyze it. If you want to change the day, then you can announce in advance. Hey, I want to shift it to say Tuesday from now onwards, but then stick to it for a while. So your audience will love the consistency part of it.
Probably go with like a longer period initially, and then once you look back and you have like maybe a whole room full of contents that you have, then you can say that, okay, I'll lower the frequency. So because what happens is the main thing is the content. If you start with a regular thing, it's like, oh God, what do I put in the next? That's where it stops. So if you have a longer term, you have enough time to put content in your letter. And then gradually, once you have a whole bunch of content, which you can just say, okay, I can just pick and choose, then you can lower the frequency.
Because that break fast and make fast, move fast thing does not work in non-funded world. Unless you have all the money in your pocket, you can do that. But boss, we don't have that kind of money in our pockets. So we'll have to like be very patient with building our communities. So I know that people tend to be impatient. Are they unka like so many audience all of a sudden? But they had money in their pockets. They could spend, they can buy their audience, they can rent their audience.
Correct.
Anyone else has interesting information, idea to share, which we should work in the future, work on in the future?
Yeah, Abhishek, one last thing. Like, I know that this is mostly due to newsletters, but everyone out there is basically about getting the word across. For that, WhatsApp business is working very well for me. So it's also like Facebook is now shifting its focus towards WhatsApp as the next big thing. So just like for everyone out there, if they want to just get another GeoSIM or something, sign up and you could like send a message to 56 people with a single click. That works well.
Yes. So that's another thing. I mean, because people are already using WhatsApp very often these days.
The open rates are like 95%. That's like personal research as well as secondary.
So when you hit 256, you buy another SIM?
No. When you hit 256, you just create another group. So you can create labels out there. In a label, you could add 256 people and can create infinite labels. So just multiple clicks.
Or you could just shift to Telegram.
Telegram, you have to download another app. WhatsApp already is there on every.
I don't know. I have this kind of relationship with Telegram where I have a whole bunch of people joining in and nobody messages me on that. So I'm like, literally, like, you know, every week I think, should I remove this? But then somebody else just joins in and then doesn't message me. So that's it.
So another thing about WhatsApp, every message is sent in a private chat window. So. Yeah. It's a direct one-on-one connection. So if somebody wants to send feedback to me or like mention or send recommendations on their own video, it's a direct communication with the audience. So,
and more people use WhatsApp in our community, in our country, because being WhatsApp what it is, so ubiquitous, it's like everyone's...
It's there. It's
already even there. Someone like me who hates WhatsApp has to use WhatsApp. There's no other option.
Seriously. You can't turn off notifications for that particular app.
Thankfully, they've made a mute unlimited, I think, now.
Yeah, there's a mute always button now.
Which is a good thing for me, because I have around 150 groups, which suddenly in 1 hour, you'll have 400 messages, and I'm like, I'm not reading those.
Yeah. Same with me, like, I've joined a few reading groups out there. I get a lot of very cool stuff to read, but they get lost in like 500, 600 messages, which...
Yeah.
Great. So I think there's another session where Nitin and Cicero can help us with the hacks of WhatsApp and Instagram, which we don't know. Because I'm a noob there. I just don't know anything about it. We'll have another session.